mind kind of percolating for a number of years, and hopefully this will have some meaning to those that are wondering what needs to happen for the Lord to return, and we are to be eagerly awaiting. They were eagerly awaiting in the first century. So what happened between that expectation of the first century and now we're 60 generations removed from that time? Now we know that we're very close because of Israel being back in the land, fulfilling ancient prophecies in Ezekiel 36 and Isaiah 11:11 and 12. They are back in the land. So we know that we're living in the generation, but what is it that the Lord is waiting for? So that's what we will look at in the scripture, and we'll trust that this will be helpful to those that have a desire to be perhaps more in synchronization with the Lord and His movements. So we'll just start with this passage in 1 Timothy 6, verse 13, where Paul is writing to Timothy. He says in 1 Timothy 6:13, I charge you in the presence of God who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep the commandment without stain or reproach until the appearing, the epiphany of our Lord Jesus Christ, until which he will bring about at the proper time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one of man, that is, no one of that old Adamic species, has seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. So here we see in this passage that there is an until. And that's what we're going to be looking at. We're going to be looking at several untils that are found in Scripture that are governing phrases that put qualifying conditions on the return of the Lord. And it says in verse 15 that he'll bring about at the proper time. What is that time? What governs that time from God's thinking? I would just begin by giving a little background how I came to be thinking in these terms a number of years ago when I was studying Ephesians. Verse by verse, it was Ephesians 4:13. When I came to that passage, I was rather struck by the language, and the Lord just turned on the lights, and it began to open up for me that which forever changed the way I saw the Word of God. In Ephesians chapter 4, Paul is talking about the ascended Christ and how in his ascension he gave specific headship gifts to the church for the equipping of the church. In 4:11 of Ephesians, he gave some apostles, some prophets, and some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, for the work of ministry, so that the saints who are equipped by these headship gifts might together corporately be building up the body of Christ until we all attain the unity of the faith and of the full knowledge of the Son of God to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. So when I was reading that, I noticed the little preposition there, until, the qualifying term, until. And in the Greek grammar, that is known as an indefinite temporal clause. So when it says, until we all attain, an indefinite temporal clause basically means this. It represents a contingency. In other words, it's a qualifier that certain things must take place until, before what is described here, occurs. The equipping of the church, the building up the church, is to go on until we all attain. Now notice that's in the plural. And as I was reading that, I said, okay, we all, and the word until we all attain, the word attain, katantao, means to arrive at the goal. God has a goal in history. Paul in Ephesians chapter 1, with reference to the ascended Christ, Ephesians 1, verse 22, he put all things in subjection under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body. The church, which is his body. So there's only one universal church, and it's the organic, living body of Christ made up of born-again believers. It gets alive. The body, which is the fullness of him who fills all in all. Now, the body is not yet the fullness of him, because that fullness is not yet attained, but that's God's purpose. The actual fullness of Christ must actually become a reality in his body. And until that happens, history will go on until this goal is attained. So So as I was reading this a number of years ago, I was struck by the fact that there's a plural there. We all are to arrive at the goal of the unity of the faith being the whole content of the New Testament, which is the object of our faith. The faith, once and for all, delivered to the saints, Jude 3. The faith, that whole body of truth. There is a unity of the faith where all that which represents the truth comes into a unifying whole, an organic whole. And that comes by revelation, Ephesians 1, 17 and following, a spirit of wisdom and revelation. So there's a goal to seeing the organic wholeness of the faith, that objective revelation of God's truth found in the New Testament, and specifically the mystery that Paul refers to, which we will look at here shortly. So one, the goal for the church is to attain the unity of the faith. Two, and of the full knowledge of the Son of God. Sonship and all that it means to be many sons in union with the Son, that full knowledge of the Son of God, and then it says, to a mature man. We all, plural, are to attain to a mature man. That's in the singular. When I saw that, that's corporate. The church is a corporate new man. That's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 15. There's just one corporate new humanity of which Christ is the head, and everyone who is born again in this dispensation make up members of his body. You take the members of the body and the head, that's called the Christ. In fact, we will just note that briefly here by looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 12. It is so important that we understand Paul's thinking as he's describing the various gifts and the ministries and the effects of these ministries in terms of the body of Christ. In 1 Corinthians 12, 4 and following, and Romans 12, 3 and following, we see in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 12, he uses our physical body as an illustration. He says, even as the body, that is, the physical body, is one, and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are one body, so also is. Literally, there's a definite article in the original. The Christ. The Christ. Why didn't he say the church? So also is the church. That would have been true, but he said the Christ. So what does that imply? That Jesus, being unique as the eternal Son of God, in union with a perfected humanity, Son of God and Son of Man, he's the head, and that's the unique position that he has because he's God-man, and we are joined to him in a many-membered body. And head and body are called the Christ. The Christ. Or you could say, the Messiah. Because Christ means the Anointed One. That's part of the great mystery that was revealed to Paul. Romans 16, 25 and 26. And Ephesians 1, 9 through 11. Ephesians 3, 1 through 11. Colossians 1, 25 through 27, we see this mystery. And mystery in the original means a sacred secret. Mysterion means a sacred secret. This was gradually unveiled to Paul as the nation of Israel continued to harden their heart during that Acts period. And they confirmed their hardness with the destruction of Jerusalem by Titus in 70 AD. And so progressively, as Israel was temporarily being set aside, God began to disclose a secret, as those passages I referred to, which was hidden from past ages, but now is made known to the saints. And that is the governing revelation for the entire dispensation, or this economy that describes God's plan for the church age. It's as if the prophetic clock stopped on Palm Sunday. We see that in Luke 19. It stopped on Palm Sunday, the 483 years that were prophesied in Daniel 9. On Palm Sunday, they were fulfilled. And the prophetic clock stops. And it's like all of heaven just holding their breath. What is Israel going to do with their Messiah? They crucify him. And the prophetic clock has been stopped since Palm Sunday. And it wasn't until Israel became a nation in 1948 that that prophetic clock began to have movement towards the consummation. And so that prophetic clock is still on hold in the sense that in the Daniel 9 passage, the 70 weeks of Daniel, that is when the covenant is made with Antichrist, then that prophetic clock will start again. But we see prophecies being fulfilled leading up to that event, with Israel returning to the land, Isaiah 11:11-12, Ezekiel 36:37. We see this reality happening. Once that covenant is made, that will start the prophetic clock again. There'll be 7 years remaining on Israel's calendar, and then Jesus Christ will return with his church from heaven to establish his kingdom here on earth for 1,000 literal years. The mystery, and this is so important to understand Paul's word of the mystery is not the salvation of the Gentiles. That was prophesied in the Old Testament. There's no secret. You read Romans 15, Paul quotes the Old Testament about the fact that God had a plan for the Gentiles to be saved. Many prophecies about the purpose of God saving Gentiles, but it was always in relation to the reestablishment of Israel as a nation, the nation of Israel being exalted as the head of nations, and then in relationship with Israel, the nations would come into the fullness of the blessing of the seed of Abraham. Well, Israel rejected Messiah. What about God's plan for the Gentiles? Well, that was a major part of the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15. God began to open up his purpose for the church, which is not made up of Jew or Gentile. The church is a completely new organism. It has the life of the glorified Son of God, and in union with Christ, who is the head of the new creation, the church is a new creation. It's a whole new species of humanity, according to Ephesians 2:15 and other places. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. There was no new creation until Christ was raised from the dead. This is all a mystery. Just looking at this verse right here in Corinthians, the mystery is that there is the Christ head and body. Just so that we understand this a little more clearly, in Ephesians chapter 1, we see the same language used with reference to the Christ. Remember, the Christ is a many-membered organic whole. I think before I read that passage in Ephesians 1, I want to read the passage in Romans chapter 12 and help us to see the organic wholeness of the mystery of the Christ, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12:12. Now in Romans 12, he, writing by the Spirit, says in verse 3, "For through the grace given to me, I say to every man among you not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think so as to have sound judgment, as God has allotted to each a measure of faith. For just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ." One body in Christ. There's the organic wholeness, or the unity. Actually, the grammar there means in the sphere of Christ. Christ, the Messiah, is the sphere of the many members' action and identity. Then he goes on to say, "So we, who are many, are one body in Christ," verse 5, "and individually," notice, "living organic members one of another." Members one of another. And then if we note in Ephesians chapter 4, and this is all a part of that great mystery, Paul says, "Laying aside the lie," falsehood, "speak truth each one of you with his neighbor, for we are members of one another." Living organic members of one another. We don't lie to our hand or any part of our body, because that is counterproductive, obviously. So we're not only members of one another, but Ephesians chapter 5, verse 30 says we are members of his body. Members of his body. Head and body are called the Christ. On the way back to Ephesians, we'll have this note a few passages in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We read that verse in 1 Corinthians 12:12 and 13. In verse 13, "By one Spirit," this is a Pentecost, it's a one-time event, "we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slave or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit." Notice verse 14, "For the body is not one member, but many." He talks about the various functions of the body and how that one member should not be prejudiced or living in a way that is discrediting the other member. In verse 20, "But now there are many members," but notice, one body. Many members, but one body. He goes on to say in verse 26, "If one member suffers, all members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all members rejoice with it. Now you are Christ's body, and individually members of it. And members, again, is a living, organic thing. Going back to Ephesians chapter 1, Paul makes mention of the mystery of God's will in Ephesians 1:9. He made known to us the mystery of his will according to his kind intention, which he purposed in him with a view to an administration, a dispensation, that governs the entire dispensation of the church from Pentecost to the rapture, with a view to a divine economy, an administration. It is an orderly arrangement. It is like the ordering of a household. And this divine economy is suitable to the fullness of times. That is, the summing up and reuniting under one head, anakaphaleo, all things in the Christ. In the Christ. So Christ is the head, but head and body make up the Christ. From Pentecost to the rapture, everything that has been disintegrated by the fall, everything that has come in from the fall of Satan and the fall of man through the church, God is now summing up and reuniting all things in the Christ, head and body. That's going on right now. And the first phase is all things in the heavens. That's what's taking place right now between Pentecost and the rapture. And then verse 10, he says, and things upon the earth, that will take place in the thousand-year reign of Christ. In him also, literally, in the Greek, it's passive voice, we were made an inheritance. We are God's inheritance, having been foreordained according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will, to the end that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, should be to the praise of his glory. That's just tremendous. When I was thinking about this particular interview, I'm so aware of the vastness of the magnitude of Paul's grasp of the mind of Christ, the insight that God gave him. Scholars have tried to fathom that for centuries, and he's still beyond our reach. This man, when he was apprehended by God, and he was dealt with in a mighty way, he went through many kinds of sufferings to capacitate him for this revelation. He is without peer when it comes to being a human vessel of that which reveals God's purpose, not only for this dispensation, but for all eternity. It's called the purpose of the ages in Ephesians 3:11. So when we come to Ephesians chapter 3, Paul says, for this reason, summing up all that he has said in terms of the one new man of Ephesians 2:15, which is also a corporate temple which is being built together. We are being built together into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom we are being fitted together into a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. That's where he leaves off in chapter 2. Then in chapter 3 he says, for this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles, if indeed you've heard of the stewardship, that is, the administration of this divine economy, this plan that governs his household. He is a steward. He was chosen by God for this. This grace was given to me for you, that by revelation that was made known to me, the mystery. The mystery. That is, the sacred secret, as I wrote before in brief. He mentions that in Romans 16:25-26 and Ephesians 1:9, which I wrote before in brief. And by referring to this, when you read, you can understand my comprehensive insight. Now, here it is, into the mystery of, here it is, the Christ. Jesus as the coming Messiah was no mystery. That's clearly prophesied in the Old Testament. Hundreds of prophecies were fulfilled. And the Christ means the Messiah. The mystery of the Messiah. What is the mystery of the Messiah? That head and body make up a corporate Christ, a corporate Messiah. No Jew had any hope that they would be a living member of the Messiah. Like it says in Isaiah 48, I will not give my glory to another. God speaking there in context to the nation of Israel. I'll just turn to that passage so people can have that as a reference. God says in Isaiah 48, verse 11, For my own sake I will act. For how can my name be profaned? And Israel had profaned his name, but he's not going to let him go. His purpose will be realized with reference to Israel. He says, and my glory I will not give to another. But when you turn to John 17:22, what does Jesus pray? Father, the glory that you have given me, this is the God-man, I have given to them that they may be one, even as we are one. There's a change. There is something tremendous that is beginning to be disclosed as Jesus is getting ready to go to the cross. Israel will reject their Messiah, and that becomes the occasion for God's secret plan to begin to be unfolded progressively. And the primary agent was the Apostle Paul. So he says, it's called the mystery of the Christ, which in other generations was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets in the Spirit. Be specific that the Gentiles are joint heirs. Joint heirs with who? Some of your translations have Israel. There is no Israel in there. We're joint heirs with Christ. Romans 8, verse 16 and 17. We're heirs of God, joint heirs with the Messiah. Israel is not a joint heir with Messiah. Even in the NIV, they've inserted Israel there. This is not about Israel, because in the body of Christ, we see in Colossians chapter 3, verse 11, and Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28, in Christ there's neither Jew or Gentile. The church is a new creation. There is no Jew, there's no Gentile. It's a new species of humanity. He says, we are fellow heirs. We are fellow heirs with Christ, not Israel, with Christ. That's a big difference. Fellow members of the body. The body of Christ, fellow associates, fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Notice one promise. Christ is promised as Messiah to Israel, but we share in the promise of the Messiah. In other words, we partake of the Messiah. We become members of the Messiah. So every time when you go through your New Testament and when you read the word Christ, just put in the word Messiah, the anointed one. He goes on to describe his ministry there, verse 7, of which I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me according to the working of his power, that's resurrection power. To me, the very least of all saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of, here it is, the Christ, head and body. That goes back to Ephesians 1, 17 to 19, where Paul prays that God would give his people a spirit of wisdom and revelation and the full knowledge of him, that the eyes of our heart would be flooded with light, that we would know three things. What? The hope of his calling. And then second, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? And what is the exceeding greatness of his power that works towards us who believe? So it's the inheritance in the saints. This is the riches of the Christ. It's just off the scale when you begin to think about it, but it's the unfathomable. In the Greek means that which cannot be traced. It can't be tracked out. It is without bounds. It is so immense, the unfathomable, the untraceable riches of Christ. And to bring to light what is the administration, the divine economy, that plan which governs this dispensation of the mystery, which for ages has been hidden in God who created all things, in order that the manifold wisdom, the much variegated manifold wisdom of God might now, from Pentecost to the rapture, be made known through the church to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance. In other words, this was in conformity with the eternal purpose which he carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord. The eternal purpose, not purposes, one purpose. In other words, something has to take place. Now, in order to grasp the mind of God, and what I'm going to be sharing with you, it is not fathomable. It can only come by revelation, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. In Colossians, the emphasis is upon Christ as the head of the church, head of creation, and as the head, he is head over all rule, authority, and principality and power. In Colossians, we see all the fullness of God in Christ, who is the head of the church. And so we'll just notice a few passages in Colossians, and then we'll come back to Ephesians, because Colossians is the companion to Ephesians. So the emphasis upon Christ, who is supreme head. We note in Colossians, first of all, 1:15, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. Now remember, when God created Adam in his image, that image was tarnished. That image was marred. But now, God has a man at his right hand. He is eternally God, but in his humanity, there is God's ideal for his people. He's the visible image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. Firstborn means he holds the highest place of prerogative and honor. Why? For in him all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things, notice again, have been created through him. God the Father is the source. Jesus is the agent, and through him everything is stamped and bears the mark of Christ. And it's for him, for Christ. And he is before all things, and in him all things, ta panta, the entire new creation, and that which will represent the new heavens and new earth, all things right now hold together in him. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, that is the ultimate source and the origin, firstborn from the dead. Again, firstborn is a title of preeminence, of rank, so that he himself might come to have first place in everything. Why? For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the pleroma to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself. So again, all the fullness to dwell in him. Notice Colossians 2:9. In him, all the fullness of deity, that is the Godhead, dwells, or is at home, in bodily form. What do you mean bodily? In a man. Amazing. We have a man in glory that is crowned with glory and honor, Hebrews 2:5-9, and in this one man, all the fullness of the Godhead is at home. And Paul is writing this as a polemic against the heresy, the New Age heresy, the syncretism of Judaism and New Age thinking, that is esoteric thinking, that you had to go through a hierarchy of angels to come into God's fullness. It was like a hierarchical system that through worship of angels, you move through a hierarchy. And then Jesus is the head of that hierarchy, like a series of aeons, and he's included in these aeons. And Paul says, not at all. He's not one of the many, even at the top of the angelic order of aeons. In him, all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily. He's head over all principality. He created all these things. All things are created through him. So all the fullness of the Godhead dwells in him bodily. This is dealing with the deception that was coming in there, verse 8. And in him you have been brought to fullness, literally, and he is head over all rule and authority. And then he goes on and talks about the corporate circumcision of that old humanity that is dead in Adam, and that in Christ we become a new creation through union with him in his death, burial, and resurrection. Absolutely tremendous. So, what's the point? Well, in Christ we see all the fullness of God. All the fullness of God. That fullness is the completeness of that which is the revelation of God in his character, in his nature, who God is. We see it in the perfected manhood of Christ. So in Christ, as head, we see the fullness of God. Now when you come to Ephesians, that fullness is to come into the church. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. The church, which is his body, the fullness of him, that's God's goal, who fills all things in all. In other words, right now, God, through Christ, by the Holy Spirit, is bringing to fullness all that will make up the new heavens and new earth. That is taking place now in the church of the firstborn, Hebrews 12, and that is taking place in and through every member joined to the head. It's a vast thing. It is so comprehensive that Paul says, even though I was at Ephesus for 3 years, and Acts 20, I taught you the whole counsel of God, even though I taught you the whole counsel of God, God apprehended him, allowed him to be in prison for 4 years, and now God takes that which is the whole counsel of God, which he gave to them in Acts 20, prior to his prison experience, and God says, there's more, Paul. Yes, you gave them the whole counsel of God, but I'm going to dilate that whole counsel, and I am going to roll back the heavens so you can see my heart and my plan from everlasting to everlasting as it relates to Christ and the church. It is that which governs the very dispensation. I think in order for people to really be helped with this, because it really takes time to get into the heart and mind of Paul, you say, well, we should be out evangelizing. Well, if that was the supreme goal, then what justified God taking Paul on a very busy evangelistic schedule and locking him up for 4 years and making him a prisoner of Nero, which Paul recognizes he was a prisoner of Christ? And why was he made a prisoner of Christ? Why was he put in prison? He tells us. Was it for the sake of saving everyone? Not at all. Notice he says in Ephesians 6:19, pray on my behalf that utterance may be given to me to open my mouth to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in proclaiming it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. The mystery of the gospel isn't how to get saved. There's no mystery in that. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. What is the mystery of the gospel? The gospel there is not born again. It's the good news for the church. It is that comprehensive plan and purpose of God that he has just defined in Ephesians 1, 2, and 3. The mystery of the gospel is the mystery of Christ, and I'll prove that to you. The mystery of the gospel in Ephesians 6:19 is described by Paul when he practically makes the same request in Colossians 4 verse 2. He says, devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving, very similar to what we see in Ephesians 6:18 and 19. Praying at the same time for us as well, the apostolic delegates of God, that God may open to us a door for the word, that we may speak forth the mystery of the gospel. That's Ephesians 6:19. Here he defines the mystery of the gospel as the mystery of the Christ, for which I have also been in prison. I'm in prison for the mystery of the Christ, that God would have such a deposit, and he refers to it as that deposit in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 14. The sacred trust is this revelation. It is that which is to govern our thinking, and we're going to see in more studies here that that which governs God's purpose is twofold. The church must attain the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. We'll come back to that. That's on one side. On the other side, the fullness of the Gentiles must come into the body of Christ in Romans 11:25. That's evangelism. If you have evangelism without purpose, it eventually loses its power and ability to penetrate darkness. If you have just all edification, no evangelism, it gets top-heavy and it'll eventually fall over. So there must be a synchronization, and it can't be one versus the other. It must go together. And that message opened the door for me to go into China, and I have been asked to go back again. I'm just waiting on the Lord for this. And I was able to share that with hundreds of house church leaders in China and seven provinces in the year 2007. The Lord opened up the door for this revelation to be deposited to a people who are prepared. They are prepared. They're not dull of hearing like we see in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11 through 14. The believers there, who by that time should have been teachers, but they were dull of hearing. They didn't have the spiritual capacity. Or like the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, they were immature babes that were still carnal and fleshly. Therefore, they could not receive the things of God. Paul is praying that this revelation would be given to the church. Now, going back to Ephesians chapter 4, we see all the fullness of God is in Christ. Now, that fullness is to be represented and come to fullness in the church. Ephesians 4:13, here's the goal of history. All the headship gifts are given in Ephesians 4:12 for the equipping, the restoration, even the mending of the saints for the work of ministry, to the building up the body of Christ until we all, plural, attain, we all arrive at the goal. To the unity of the faith, singular, and of the full knowledge of the Son of God, singular, it's all corporate, to a mature man, corporate, a mature man, a man, Christ the head, and a many-membered body make up one new man, Ephesians 2:15. A mature man, what's the goal? That mature man is the goal for history. That mature man is to attain the measure of the stature, the full-grown stature, which characterizes or is defined as the fullness of Christ. In other words, the very fullness of the Messiah. That is a revelation that was never given in the Old Testament, that the head and body would make up the Christ, 1 Corinthians 12:12. And this fullness that's now in Christ, and his glorified humanity would now be corporately expressed and corporately manifested through a many-membered body. From Pentecost to the rapture, every believer that's been born again has added, and each member, according to their growth, as they progressively die and become conformed to Christ in his death, and then gradually the measure of Christ comes to formation in each one, and each part is contributing to the whole. And once the church corporately attains the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, the rapture will occur. The rapture will occur, because that is the goal of history. All the exhortations of Ephesians 4, 1 through chapter 6 are all a part of our responsibility to walk in the truth and to relate to one another according to this revelation. So the goal is to attain the measure of the stature, and again, it's the Christ. It's corporate. All the fullness of the Godhead is already in him, Colossians. Now that fullness is to be communicated and to be shared, and the church is to attain that fullness. And it's all corporate. This massive plan has been going on since Pentecost. All suffering, all generations, the hundreds that have been saved, those believers that have not gone on to fullness and have defected like Demas, having loved this present age, have gone off to Thessalonica. But those that have gone on with the Lord and have overcome in every generation, each one has contributed to that which is meeting the divine criterion of coming to the goal, mentioned in Ephesians 4:13. That is a tremendous thing. In order to understand this until, remember that's an indefinite temporal clause. I'm going to turn to Galatians chapter 4. This is a region known as Galatia. These churches were founded by God through Paul and his ministry. And they had started to run well and to advance, but the Judaizers had come in and they were now coming back under the law, and they began in the Spirit, and now through going back under the law, that takes them out of the new creation experientially, because the law has nothing to say to the new creation. The new creation is governed by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, not by any external law. That is Romans 8, 2 and following, along with 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 and following. The Holy Spirit takes the place of the law. In the Old Testament, the law governed that relationship with believers. But under the new covenant, it's the Spirit that takes the place of the law. Here we have these Galatians who had defected. He says in Galatians 3, "You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified? This is the only thing I would find out from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of the faith? Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are you now coming to maturity, being perfected by the flesh?" He's indicting them. He is really upset. And he goes on, and he continues to deal with them. He says in Galatians 4:16, "Have I become your enemy by literally being the truth? They, these Judaizers, eagerly seek you, not commendably, but they wish to shut you out in order that you may seek them. But it is good always to be eagerly sought in a commendable manner, such as what Paul is doing now, and not only when I'm present with you." Now watch this, verse 19, "My children, with whom I am again in labor, like a woman in travail to give birth, until the Messiah is formed in you." The Messiah formed in the people? Where do you find that in the Old Testament? Where do you find anything that says it's God's purpose that the Messiah be formed in people? And that word form, morphe, it means a formation whereby who we are on the inside conforms to Christ in his character and likeness and image. And that is seen on the outside. There's no cover-up, no sham. It is a morphe. In other words, you can have an M&M, which is chocolate on the inside and a sugar coating on the outside. That would be schema. But if it's morphe, it would be chocolate on the inside all the way to the outside with no covering. Morphe. I'm in travail again until the Messiah be fully formed in you. What a plan. Why did he say that to the Galatians? Because that's God's plan for the whole dispensation. So in other words, the rapture will not occur until the Messiah has been fully formed in all the features that govern his perfection in the entire body of Christ corporate. Each person will participate in a measure of that. Some to a great degree like Paul, and some like Demas who forsook Paul, he will bear a small measure. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, "As one star differs from another glory, so will the resurrection be. In the resurrection, all believers will have a resurrection body, but some will be saved so as through fire and suffer great loss." And 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 and 11, "There will be those that have a wide entrance into the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ." So some will have full reward, that is a full measure, and each person in varying measures will eventually comprehensively and corporately represent the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, Ephesians 4:13. What's retarded the Lord's returning? Well, the Galatians were coming under the law. Rather than living by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, they were coming back under the law, and so the Christ being formed in them was beginning to dwindle, to shrink, and to shrivel. That's retarding the Lord's return. How can a church attain the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ if you're in the Galatian error? Throughout history, we've had all these issues of Galatianism or lawlessness like we see in Corinthians and all these various problems and sectarian issues. And so all this retards the purpose. And that's why the day of visitation, which I've spoken briefly on, the day of visitation will be God's breaking into history to bring this whole process to consummation. The day of visitation will be God's initiation when he breaks in. And those who have been hanging on, hoping in God, there will be a change of destiny, there will be an infusion of resurrection life, and there will be a testimony of Jesus known as the bright morning star. And then there will be those that will be exposed for their nakedness, and as we see in Revelation chapter 3, verse 16, God will vomit them out of his mouth. And this is not a loss of salvation. This is a loss of one's inheritance and the purpose that he has redeemed us in time. There's a huge difference. That's the whole issue of the book of Hebrews. It's not about loss of salvation, it's about loss of inheritance. For example, the rewards passage, we see that we will all be manifest at the bema seat of Christ, that we might receive what was done through the body, whether good or worthless, 2 Corinthians 5:10. We must all appear at the judgment seat of God, as it says in Romans 14. John makes mention of this matter in 2 John, verse 8. Watch yourselves, he says, watch yourselves, that you might not lose, L-O-S-E, lose what we have accomplished, but that you may receive full, F-U-L-L, full reward. What does that mean? It's God's purpose that everyone receive full reward. Each person in their own measure attain the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ in measure. And when you put all the measures together, it's one measure. It will embody the fullness of God in Christ. And the church is the complement of Christ as his bride. The bride will display the fullness of the bridegroom. That's the communicable attributes of God. In other words, the attributes of God that have to do with his infinity, his eternity, we can't share in that. Those are non-communicable. His omniscience, his omnipotence, his omnipresence. But those attributes that are moral and spiritual, that are communicable, that are now in possession of Jesus Christ as the God-man, and who he is in his perfected manhood. Those are all to be shared and come into the church. Christ in his glorified humanity, all that fullness that's in him, is to be mirrored and to have a counterpart and to be seen in through the church once the church attains the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Once Christ is fully formed in the church. That's why history goes on, because that divine criteria has not been met. I am in travail again until Christ be fully formed in you. Why? Because that's the goal for the entire dispensation. Paul understood it. And so we look at that verse, we got to stand back and see the magnitude of what he's talking about, because it's that which governs the purpose of God for believers. They were already believers. Galatians chapter 4, verse 12, I beg of you, brethren, he's talking to Christians. It isn't about, did they lose their salvation or were they not really saved? They were saved. They're referred to as brethren. So we have this divine criteria that must be met. Now that's the vertical. We will go ahead and look at one more passage that has to do with the until. Again, remember, until is an indefinite temporal clause. Peter makes reference to this principle in 2 Peter chapter 1 when he refers to the goal of the final generation of manifesting in a corporate way Christ as morning star. There have been individuals that have attained this throughout history, but there will be a corporate realization of the fullness of Christ seen in a company of believers, those who are alive and surviving in the coming of the Lord. There'll be the manifestation of Christ as the morning star. And 2 Peter 1:19, the governing principle here is 2 Peter 1:4, for by these, that is God's glory and virtue, God has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises in order that by them you might become partakers of the divine nature by having escaped the corruption that's in the world by lust. Partaker of the divine nature, that's the glorified humanity. That's the perfected manhood of Jesus Christ. That's the gold refined in fire that Jesus refers to in Revelation chapter 3 to the church of Laodicea. He says, we have the prophetic word made more sure. Talking about the Mount of Transfiguration, which is the crowning fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies pertaining to the second coming of the Lord. We see that proleptically fulfilled in Jesus Christ on the mountain. And as we've gone through this before on Christ as the Morning Star, this is to be represented in the church morally and spiritually at the end. He says, so we have the prophetic word made more sure, referring to the Mount of Transfiguration, to which you do well to pay attention, the prophetic word, as to a lamp shining in a dark, squalid, murky, dirty place. That's what this world is now, with the absence of Christ. Until, there's another indefinite temporal clause, until, the Holy Spirit doesn't say when it's going to happen. There are no prophecies that tell us when we will attain the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, or when the Messiah will be fully formed in his people, his men and member body. But until the day dawns, that is, that renewed but lost hope of the coming of the Lord that was revived after the Reformation, primarily, and the morning star arises, morning star singular arises in your hearts, plural, never been fulfilled in history. This will be the outcome of the day of visitation, 1 Peter 2:12. This will bring history to its consummation as far as the church age. We have that until that is governing the entire dispensation. And now I want to go and look at the complement of this in Romans chapter 11. There is a complement of that purpose, the vertical purpose of the church attaining the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Ephesians 4:15 is God's purpose that we together are to grow up into him with reference to all things, who is the head, from whom the whole body is being fitted and held together and is growing together towards that goal, Ephesians 4:16. The purpose of evangelism is that immediately believers become a part of a local church so that this organic relationship can begin to be worked out as we bump against each other and we have to deal with all the kinds of things that are in us that are not according to Christ. The church, in a lot of respects, is a hospital where we are in the process of being perfected. We're not perfected. There's no perfect church on earth. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 25 through 29, when the great shaking comes, when God shakes that which can be shaken, as of created things, that would include anything that is of the spot and wrinkle of the old humanity. When that day of visitation comes, it will produce the shaking. And that shaking will bring everything down to the divine criteria according to Christ. That's what the visitation will produce. And the result will be the perfections of Christ seen in a body. And it's going to come through fire. It's going to come through fire. That may be discouraging to people. It doesn't discourage me at all. I beg God for the fire because I know that if there's anything of Doug Riggs, according to Adam, that doesn't go into death and cannot be resurrected, at the bema seat of Christ, it will result in loss. When I stand at the bema seat of Christ, I want the fire of the bema to have already passed through me, or for me to have passed through that which represents the fire of the bema seat. So when I stand before Jesus Christ and I'm subjected to the fire of the bema seat, the scrutiny of his perfection, that perfected manhood, I suffer no loss. I stand there in that measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ that God had his heart set on from eternity past. So I'm there in full reward. God deserves giving him the glory by allowing him to give me full reward. It's more blessed to give than to receive. So why should we not allow God to be most blessed by giving us full reward? If it's more blessed to give and receive, I want him to give me full reward so he can be most blessed and I can enter into that blessing. It's all positive. There is no provision for those that do not go all the way with God. God is positive. He's made provision for every believer to be an overcomer and to have full reward so that in that measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, they will fulfill that destiny. Those who do not, history goes on longer. And what about that measure that Demas or some of those Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 30, some of these Corinthians were dying the sin unto death. They were dying. They never attained the measure that God had for them. So where does that measure go? Well, it's very simple. It goes to the people like Paul. Here's the answer. Colossians 1:24. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. And in my flesh, my mortal body, I do my share on behalf of his body, which is the church, and literally in filling up again and again the deficiency, that which is lacking in Christ's affliction. This is not his afflictions on the cross for our sins. This is Christ being formed in his church. It is travail. We see in Romans 8 The Godhead is travailing until Christ be fully formed in his body. Some are not going all the way. Paul says, okay, Lord, I'll step in and I will take that up for you. I will fill up my part the affliction of those who, for whatever reason, are not ready or not willing to go on with you, Lord. I am willing to share because Christ is suffering in his body. In what way? To have the capacity where the fullness of Christ is in his body. That's what he's saying. That's the corporate side in terms of the vertical, the growth side. What about evangelism? In Romans chapter 11, we have this marvelous passage, and Paul is speaking to the Romans as Gentiles. He's not talking to them as the church. It is a contrast between Gentiles as Gentiles and Israel as a people. And the question is God through with Israel? Has he cast them off? He makes it very clear that he has not cast away those whom he has chosen. When God made a promise to Abraham that in his seed all the nations would be blessed, Israel was the nation that was the first called out to represent that corporate seed. When Jesus came, that generation forfeited the purpose of God. The promises God gave to Abraham, that's the root of the tree, and they are the branches. And then there's the lump of dough, who was first holy, talking about the covenant God made with Abraham. That's all found in Romans 11. The root and the lump, he uses two illustrations. But the branches were broken off, that is, the nation of Israel in our Lord's time. He talks about that they're broken off, but then now we as Gentiles, well, wild olive, we're grafted in, and we share in that blessing that God promised to Abraham. That in his seed, the Messiah, all nations would be blessed. So he's talking to them with Gentiles. And he goes on and he makes that very clear that once the Gentiles, that God has purposed to be grafted into that which represents the Abrahamic covenant, he says, then all Israel will be saved. So he goes on, verse 25, I do not want you, brethren, to be uninformed of this mystery, this secret. Now, what is the secret? In the previous verses, the nation of Israel rejected God's purpose for them in the Messiah coming to bring redemption to them as a people, as a nation. They rejected. So that mystery of Israel's hardness, partial hardening, until when? For I do not want you, brethren, to be uninformed of this mystery, lest you be wise in your own estimation. You better be careful, Gentiles. You better not become anti-Semitic, or you're going to come under the judgment of God. Anti-Semitic in the sense of anti-Jewish is what I mean by that. Lest you be wise in your own estimation that a partial hardening has happened to Israel. Paul, when he used Israel, this is not spiritual Israel. You can't spiritualize Israel. This is the nation. A partial hardening has happened to Israel until, indefinite temporal clause, the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. What? To salvation. To become a part of the Christ, where there is no Jew and Gentile. And once God is finished with the church and coming to the measure of the stature and fullness of Christ, then the church will be raptured to carry out the execution of the divine criterion from the heavenlies. We covered that in the celestial court. That's why the pre-tribulation rapture is absolutely mandated, because the church is the criterion, 1 Corinthians 6, 2 and 3, through which Jesus Christ judges angels and judges the nations. That's why the church has to be in heaven. So that's why the prophetic clock is stopped with reference to Israel. And the church will be removed, and shortly after that, a covenant will be made, and that'll start the prophetic clock again. Daniel's 70th week will start up again, and there will be 7 years left of history, and Jesus Christ will return. That's all clearly outlined in Daniel and Revelation. So he says a partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. There it is, indefinite temporal clause. Evangelism is strategic because only God knows the vertical, where the church is corporately, starting from Pentecost to the present, where it is in terms of the corporate measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ on one side, and then contemporaneously with that and complementary of that, where we are in terms of the full number of Gentiles coming into the body of Christ that will complete it. It's got to be both. It can't be either or. It's got to be both. Evangelism is so the church can be built up. And then as the church is built up, the church is an evangelistic body to complete this divine program for this dispensation. And thus all Israel will be saved. We see Israel in the tribulation, that remnant will be saved. And Israel, the God had intended to be the head of the nations in the resurrection, the Old Testament saints will be there. There'll be a surviving remnant when Jesus returns, and that all Israel will be saved. And just as is written, a deliverer will come from Zion, that's the heavenly Zion, and he will remove ungodliness from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them, Israel, when I take away their sins. That will be fulfilled. Notice, the second advent cannot occur until the church is completed. Until Christ has the full armor to put on, he can't return. So we must put on the whole armor of God so that Christ will be able, as we see in Isaiah 59, to put on the whole armor of God to return and deliver Israel. Now, when you go back to Isaiah 59, it says in that passage that a deliverer will come to Zion, from heaven to Zion. That's Mount Zion in Jerusalem. That's Mount Moriah. That's the Temple Mount. He will return to the Mount of Olives, but then he will set up his throne, his millennial throne and seat of government will be Mount Moriah. It will be the Temple Mount for 1,000 years. He goes to Zion. But in this passage, Paul says a deliverer will come from Zion. What is that? That's Hebrews 12. You have come to Mount Zion. That's the heavenly counterpart. The church is the governing center of the universe. Just like Zion was the governing center of Israel and in the purpose of God ultimately, all the nations. Well, the church is the governing center, the place of divine victory. If you go back to 2 Samuel chapter 5, that's where David manifested the consolidation of his kingdom and how that kingdom was united north and south and that victory of conquering the Jebusites. It was the Jebusite stronghold, and there, that Jebusite stronghold, which was built by the enemy, occupied by the enemy, became the stronghold of David. So once that which represents the stronghold of Satan and mankind is corporately dealt with through the church, Colossians 2:11-15, it would take hours to go through all this and unpack it. But the point is that in the divine mind, in the mind of Paul, when Jesus returns with his church from heaven, and again, I'm referring to the heavenly Zion. The church is identified with the heavenly Zion in Hebrews 12:22-23. Then he comes with his church from Zion to Zion. And the Septuagint, it is amazing how this has been changed. He comes to Zion in Isaiah 59. When Paul quotes it, the Holy Spirit changes this. From, not to, from. That shows you the uniqueness of the church age, that this is a mystery. And the Holy Spirit was very meticulous to be true to that revelation that God gave Paul in prison. A deliverer will come from Zion, he will remove ungodliness from Jacob, and this is my covenant I'll make with them when I take away their sins from the standpoint of the gospel. They, that is Israel, in their hardness, they are enemies for your sake, but from the standpoint of God, they are choice, they are elect. They are beloved for the sake of the fathers. That goes back to Abraham, the root and the lump, as he talked about. So it's a tremendous thing. But the point I want to make is that we have a twofold until here, until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. That's evangelism. Now we need to look at a third until as we consider these matters. We need to turn to Acts chapter 2. Now when the Holy Spirit came, it was a result of Jesus Christ being glorified. We know in John 7:39, Jesus makes it very clear the Holy Spirit was not yet given as a permanent gift until Christ was glorified. In Acts chapter 2, we see the fact that with Christ being glorified, we see the coming of the Holy Spirit. And we see this prophecy of the resurrection of Christ in Psalm 16. And Peter makes it very clear that when David is talking about the resurrection in Psalm 16, that he's not talking about himself. He is prophesying the resurrection of Christ. And so I'll begin reading in Acts 2:29. Brethren, I may confidently say to you regarding the patriarch David, in quoting from Psalm 16 and verses 25-29, regarding the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. And so because he was a prophet, he didn't have the office of prophet, but he had the prophetic gift. He knew that God had sworn to him with an oath to seat one of his descendants upon his throne. That takes us back to the Davidic promise in 2 Samuel chapter 12 and following, in Psalm 89:3 and Psalm 132:11. This is all prophesied in the Old Testament, that there would be a descendant of David who would sit upon his throne. Well, he, David, by the Spirit, he looked ahead. He spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, and that he was neither abandoned to Hades, the place of the dead, nor did his flesh suffer decay or corruption. And this Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, Jesus, having been exalted to the right hand of God, right hand is an Oriental idiom meaning the place of highest authority and privilege and honor. Right hand, that's what that means. It doesn't mean like a physical right hand, it's just the highest place of honor and privilege and authority. And since he has been exalted to the right hand of God, notice Jesus, having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, that's in resurrection. He, the resurrected Christ, has poured forth this, which you both see and hear, Pentecost. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself has said, and he quotes Psalm 110, the Lord, Jehovah the Father, said to my Lord, Jehovah the Son, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Until. So what's the purpose of the church age? Through spiritual warfare, Ephesians 6:10 and following, that God might subdue under the feet of Jesus Christ all of God's enemies. But it's under a corporate Christ. It's a corporate Christ. That's why we are in the battle. Because we are joined to the head. He is already victorious. But the body of Christ corporate has not yet come into the victory of the head. I'll state that again. The body of Christ corporate, the corporate Christ in terms of the many-membered body, has not come into the fullness and the completeness of that victory of that head. Positionally we have, but experientially and historically we haven't. And that's why Jesus hasn't returned. So we go back to Hebrews and we see the same thing again. This is an until. This indefinite temporal clause is found twice in Hebrews. We see in Hebrews chapter 1 where Jesus is superior to angels in every way. Jesus as Son of Man is superior to angels. And that's the whole emphasis as the one in whom God has spoken with finality, that Jesus is the effulgence of God's glory, the exact representation of his character. And we see that in Hebrews 1, a tremendous passage. And then we see his superiority of angels and his role as being in union with the Father in creating the universe. And then his second coming in Hebrews 1:12, and he will roll up the heavens when he returns. He's going to establish his kingdom. His years will not come to an end. Now notice, in comparing Jesus as God's son with angels, Hebrews 1:13. But to which of the angels has God, God the Father, ever said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to render a sacred service for the sake of those who will inherit full salvation? It's full salvation. That's the book of Hebrews. That means the inheritance. So, we see that Jesus, from his resurrection until the rapture, it's Operation Footstool that is in view. Since the church is the divine criterion by which God will judge the world and judge angels, 1 Corinthians 6:2 and 3, the church is the instrument for God to crush Satan under the feet of the church. Romans 16:20, here's the ultimate prophecy of God in this matter. The God of peace, the one who has reconciled us to God through Jesus Christ, and thus established peace between God and man through the mediator, Jesus Christ, the God of peace. That's God's purpose. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The word crush is soon tribo. When Jesus came, he came to heal the brokenhearted, broken, shattered, soon tribo. I work with multiples. I work with people, survivors of satanic ritual abuse. They've been shattered. The God of peace will soon shatter Satan under your feet. Same word. But see, it has to do with stature. It has to do with spiritual ascendancy. To the measure in which we have grown up into him together in our assembly life, in our personal life, with reference to him who is all things, Ephesians 4:15, who is the head, then we displace principalities and powers. It's not about exorcism. The church is growing up in him with reference to all things. We're clearing the second heavens. And once the second heavens are cleared, Jesus will be able to descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will be raised first. And we who are the living ones, namely the survivors, the surviving remnant, shall be caught up to meet the Lord in that lower atmosphere that is now currently the headquarters of Satan, Hebrews 2, 1-3. Tremendous. This doesn't originate with me. This is the Pauline revelation. I'm only given just the little measure that God has given me through the years of this tremendous revelation. We're going to look at one more verse, then I want to conclude with a reference to help people follow up on this, because this is a lot. Obviously, this is not milk, this is meat. And I understand that. Hebrews chapter 10, he's contrasting the old economy and the Levitical priest with reference to Jesus Christ as our great high priest. Hebrews 10, verse 11. Every priest stands daily ministering and offering time after time the same sacrifices. That's under the old covenant, which can never take away sins. But he, Jesus, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God. Place of absolute victory, authority, and prerogative. Waiting. He's waiting expectantly from that time onward until indefinite temporal clause. There's no prophecy that tells us when this is going to happen. There's nothing on the prophetic calendar. The church age is that only period in history that doesn't have a prophecy on it. It's left up to us in the sense, are we going to be workers together with God to see this age consummated? Until his enemies be made a footstool for his feet. That is complete subjugation. And the church is the instrument. It's tremendous. Now I want to just refer the listeners to two works. A number of years ago when I read The Stewardship of the Mystery, you can get a whole set of these books from Emmanuel Church in Tulsa, T. Austin Sparks' writings. But you can also get this online. It's austin-sparks.net. And if you go into the book section, scroll down to The Stewardship of the Mystery, you'll see that there are two volumes, Volume 1 and Volume 2. I recommend that people read Volume 2 first because it's really an overview and a summary. And then Volume 1, you just dig into the meat. It goes into extensive detail. As I've read these numerous times, Volume 2 is such a precise, concise overview of some of the things I've been talking about today. Once you have that overview, then you go to Volume 1. It's a pretty exhaustive study. And I will say this up front. I've read it many times, and each time it's a new book to me. Because the breadth, length, and depth, and height of the spiritual capacity of this particular servant of God. Gene Edwards said this about T. Austin Sparks. I know of no other man of spiritual stature, and he read all the Church Age Saints. I know of no other man that can be compared to the Apostle Paul like T. Austin Sparks. Gene Edwards said that. It's difficult. He's not always easy to read. It takes perseverance. That's one thing, Stewardship of the Mystery, Volume 1 and 2. And then the second book I would get is God's Spiritual House. This will help fill in some of the things we're looking at. This has just opened the door, and there are other very practical things that we need to think about in terms of our everyday life, our life together in terms of assembly, that will help put flesh on this, that God is waiting for, that which represents a prerequisite for him to return for his church.